Hari Om. We shall chant from verse number 14, section 2. Anyatra dharmat, anyatra dharmat. Anyatra asmat krita kritat. Anyatra bhutaccha bhavyaccha. Yat tat pashyasi tat vada. Sarve veda yat padamamananti. Tapansi sarvani cha yad vadanti. Yadichanto brahmacharyam charanti. Tatte padam sangrahena bravimi. Om ittetat. So Yamaraji tells Nachiketa that this Atma, which is there, which is the Supreme Reality, is as though hidden in the deep cave of our own heart. One has to enter through Adhyatma Yoga, through meditation. One enters one's own heart and recognize that self and become free of this samsara. For this we have to prepare ourselves, and that happens through Shravan, Manan and Niridhyasan. So etas shrutva sam parigrihyamartyah pravruhya dharmyam anumetam apya. So through Shravan, Manan, Niridhyasan, one will be able to recognize that self, will get established in that self. And samodate modaniyam hilabdva. Such a person rejoices having attained that which is the very source of all joy. So Nachiketa, you are all fit for this. So Nachiketa asks this question, he reframes it. You please tell me that self which I have till now recognized as what it is not. It is not dharma and it is not adharma also. Because both dharma, adharma is something to do with the world and also something to do with the doer. What is dharma for one can be adharma for other. So it's all a relative term and confined to this world and to the sense of doership. But Atma is beyond the doer, and Atma is beyond all the matter. So anyatra asmat krita akritat, and it is also different from the krita, that which is done or effect, and akrita, the cause. Again, the world which we experience, it is a play of cause and effect. So there are causes which forms the effect. Those effect then again further becomes the cause, and again the effect happens. So it's like a cycle of cause and effect in which many beings are also involved. They also supply some causes, and then the effect happens. But the self, the supreme self, is different from both the cause as well as the effect. And anyatra bhutaccha bhavyaccha, it is also different from the past and the future. So that which you see, that which you have experienced, in which you are established, that tad vada, that you tell me. So Yamaraji, he begins the teaching by saying that this is the main theme of all the Vedas. All the Vedas unanimously talk about this Supreme Reality alone. Vedaischa sarvaihi ahameva vedyaha. In Gita also Bhagavan says that in all the Vedas, aham eva vedyaha. I am the Vedya, I am the theme. One has to recognize me. Vedas are just a help, which will help us to recognize our own self. And all the tapas, all the sadhana are also meant for gaining this state of enlightenment. And all seekers follow the path of brahmacharya also to attain this state. So, yadichchanto brahmacharyam charanti tatte padam sangrahena pravakshe bravimi. I will tell you that pada, that state, that self, sangrahena, briefly, and that is om. Om iti etat. So this om is the most beautiful, most sublime and most powerful mantra, also symbol, also name of that supreme reality. It is the essence of all the Vedas. Pranavas sarva vedeshu. In Gita Bhagavan says, I am the om in all the Vedas. If you remove om, nothing is there in Veda. Om, that sound, is also very beautiful. It begins with A, which is the first sound which we can utter, the basic sound. In Gita again, Bhagavan says, among all the sound, I am A. Among all the aksharas, I am A. Because it's the basic sound. Modification of this A itself is other sound. All the other vowels are just modification of this A. So A is the first sound which we utter, and U is the in-between rolling sound. That A itself becomes U. And the last sound which we can utter is humming. Some people who don't remember the words, they hum the sound. So other person feels he knows, but he's just humming. So humming that sound is the last. When we close our lips, then that sound comes. That is the ma. So a, u and ma. This is the, it covers all the sound possible. Because the first sound, in between sound, and the last sound covers all the sound possible. There cannot be any improvement on this om. You cannot have anything added to it or subtracted from it. It's the perfect sound symbol or the perfect name for God. Om. And this is the something which is a great gift given to us by the great rishis. And it is universal. It doesn't have any restriction of any religion or nation or anything. It is meant for all humanity. And sometimes we hear this sound even in nature. If you focus your attention, sometimes even from fan or something, also that sound we can get a jhalak of that sound. So it's a most beautiful sound symbol of the Supreme Reality. Om iti etat. So the greatness of this Om is further now mentioned in the following verses. So let us chant and find out how we can use this Om in our sadhana. Etat devaksharam brahma. Etat devaksharam param. etat devaksharam jnatva yo yadichati tasya tat etat devaksharam brahma etad hi eva aksharam brahma. This om itself is called, is itself brahma. This om akshar itself is brahma. And etad hi eva aksharam param, and this itself is supreme. So here two terms are used, Brahma and Param. And this Om is the Akshara, the word, which is both Brahma as well as Param. Bhagavan Shankaracharya ji, he writes in the commentary that the word Brahma indicates Sagun Brahma and the word Param indicates the Nirgun. So this Om indicates, is the name of both the transcendental Brahma as well as the Sagun Brahma, that supreme reality beyond all names and forms, and the supreme reality along with all names and forms. Both are same. Sagun means along with gunas, the Prakriti, which has got these three gunas. And Nirguna means beyond the gunas. So that supreme reality is itself by nature free from all these gunas. But that supreme alone is expressing in and through all these gunas. So Sattva-guna, Rajo-guna and Tamo-guna is experienced as this world. We experience the world of matter and activity and intelligence. This is nothing but the three gunas. And this supreme reality alone appears in and through them. It's like, suppose a person is there who is just wearing some dress. Then that person alone is appearing through the dress, through the clothing. Similarly, these gunas are as though the clothing of the supreme reality. But this clothing is such that when one transcends this clothing, they also get negated. They are not really there, because the three gunas, the tamoguna merges and disappears into rajoguna. The rajoguna merges and disappears into sattva-guna, and sattva-guna disappears into that supreme. There is no guna in the supreme. It is not there. It appeared to be there, but actually it is not there. So it just dissolves into the supreme reality. So it is one without a second, but it appears because of these gunas as though it has become many. So that same Brahma, along with the gunas, is also indicated by the term, by the sound symbol Om. And the Nirgun Nirakar is also indicated by Om. So one can do the upasana of both the Sagun as well as Nirgun with the help of Om. The scriptures are not against the Sagun Upasana. So that is also a step towards the Supreme, gaining that Supreme state. So here in this verse it is said, etat eva aksharam brahma. This akshar alone is that Brahma. This Om alone is Brahma, means the Sagun Brahma, the Supreme Reality, as though enveloped by the gunas And here when we say Ishvara or the Saguna Brahma is one who is expressing in his pure form, in the subtlest form, only through the Sattva Guna. So his Prakriti is Sattva Pradhan. Sattva Pradhan Prakriti. And that Brahma alone transcends all gunas. So with the help of this Om, we can meditate on Saguna Brahma, who is also called Ishvara, and Nirguna Brahma, transcendental Supreme Brahma. So in the beginning, the seeker needs some support. So we take the support of Ishvara. But then once our mind becomes more and more subtle, we can then meditate on that Nirguna. So etad eva aksharam brahma, etad eva aksharam param. And etad eva aksharam nyatva, and one who knows this akshara, this om, knows this means one who meditates on it, one who does the upasana of om. Depending on how one does the upasana, yo yad icchati tasya tat, according to his own icha, according to his own way of doing the upasana, whether saguna or nirguna, he attains that. If one does saguna upasana, one attains the state of that saguna brahma. And one does nirguna upasana, one attains the state of that nirguna. So yo yad icchati tasya tat. For example, when we meditate on this om, we can focus our attention on the sound a, om, and what it represents. Om is, as I said, is not only the sound, but it has got deep meaning. So that a also represents the gross physical world and that supreme reality expressing through the gross physical world, also called Virat. O also represents the subtle world, supreme reality expressing through the subtle world, called Hiranyagarbha. And Ma also represents that supreme reality expressing through the causal world, called Ishvara. So one can, in the beginning, focus one's attention on A and what it represents, then focus one's attention on A and O, then A, O, Ma, and then the entire Om and the silence. So our scriptures talk about it in elaborately about this upasana. Yeah. So one can chant that Om and meditate on the gross physical world as the expression of God. That is the first step. That is the first step in Omkar Upasana, wherein we meditate on this entire cosmos, which is made up of the five great elements, Akash, Vayu, Agni, Jal, Prithvi, the gross five elements, alone gives rise to this entire cosmos of all the stars and planets and the earth and the different beings, their bodies, all of these are made up of these five elements, which are the outermost as though the dress of Bhagwan. So one can chant that Om and just meditate on that Om as Virat, at this whole gross physical world. And look at the whole world as divine, as expressing the Supreme alone, expressing as this world. See, this is the first step. Even to get this feeling that everything is divine, we take one particular form and then meditate on that, or do its upasana or puja. but slowly it should be extended to the entire world. We take a murti and we do puja, but the whole world should be taken as the murti of Bhagwan or image of God, the entire world, entire cosmos that is represented by a particular small image. Sometimes symbolically it is represented. Like all the five elements are represented in Lord Shiva also. Akash, Vayu, Agni, Jal, Prithvi, all of them are represented in his body. Yeah? So Akash, the damru is there which makes sound. The characteristic of Akash is sound. Akash, Vayu. Vayu is the air, which is also represented by the snakes and the hissing of the snake. Akash, Vayu, Agni. Agni where? Is fire in his eyes also, and sometimes Bhagwan holds it in his hand, the fire. In Nataraj Roop, he holds the fire also. So Akash, Vayu, Agni, Jala, Gangaji is there, and Prithvi Tattva, the Bhasma which he applies. All of them are decoration on his body. So this is just a symbolic representation of that Virat Roop, that everything, all that we experience with our eye, with our senses, that is divine. That is the outermost expression or vision of God. As I have said earlier also, if somebody asks you, have you seen God? What should you say?
Yes.
You should say yes. Because with our eyes we see God only. With our hands we are touching God. It is an insult to say that I have not seen God. We have funny image about God. We want to see Him as Krishna and Rama and all. That way we won't be able to see. Or if we see, then it will be just a mental projection or in a dream. We have to see God with our senses. All that we see is the outer expression of God only. But we are so small in front of this Virat that we cannot imagine the vastness of that Supreme Reality. Even our own body, if suppose a tiny little virus, you can't even see that virus. If it has to look at you, it will look at you like Virat Purush only. Similarly, this whole entire cosmos is the physical as though expression of God, Brahma. I'm using the word God for Brahma. Ishvara or Brahma is also called, that roop of Ishvara is also called Virat. Virat is also Ishvara, Hiranyagarbha is also Ishvara, Ishvara is also Ishvara. So that physical roop of Bhagwan is called Virat. Then, as we understand and as we meditate on this, this is called the Omkar Upasana, with focusing our attention on A, then we have to meditate on the subtler aspect of God, that is the Sukshma, which is made up of our senses, the Sukshma Panchamahabhut, which are called Tanmatras. Those tanmatras, which are pure shabda, pure sparsha, shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, gandha, in their pure form, separately, individually. See, when we experience anything in this world, it is always mixed up with all those. We can, from the same object, we not only we can see, but we can hear it also. So all these five things are mixed up, therefore they are called gross. One object itself we can experience with many of our senses. But when we meditate and when we go deeper into our meditation, we will be able to hear the pure sound. It's called Shabda Tanmatra. With our physical ear, we hear the outer sound. But if we focus our attention on that ear and the ability to hear, we will be able to hear the inner sound or the subtler sound, which is the tanmatra, which is made up of the subtle five elements. Tanmatras they are called. That same tanmatras go to make our mind also. So when we just focus our attention on our senses, the power of the senses, not what the senses are seeing, but the senses themselves, they are made up of these tanmatras. So when we focus our attention on these tanmatras and our mind and our intellect, which is also made up of this tanmatra, then we, at a deeper level, we will be able to experience God in a subtler form, the subtle aspect of God. That is the subtler level of this upasana. And further, when we, our mind becomes more pure, we will be able to experience that supreme reality as shining in that sattva gun. Our mind will become extremely sattvic, and we will be able to comprehend that supreme reality as shining in that sattvic state of our mind. This is a very subtle sadhana, which is like this, the focus on the ma matra of that om. So a om, and then further that will also become what you call, one will transcend that and will be able to comprehend the silence, and that which is indicated by silence, that is the nirgun nirakar Brahma. So om itself can take us to that supreme. In Patanjali Yoga Sutra also, Patanjali Rishi talks about this samadhi, and he says that abhyas and vairagya can give you this samadhi avastha, and thereafter he says it can also be attained through Ishvara Pranidhanadva. And then he goes on to indicate who is Ishvara, and he says his name is Pranava, Om. And how to surrender to Ishvara? By chanting that Om and meditating on the meaning of Om. Tad japas tad arthava bhavanam. Tad japaha, by chanting, by doing japa of Om, that is one aspect. And tad artha bhavanam, that one should meditate on the meaning of that Om. If that is done, then that also leads us to that state of samadhi or state of enlightenment. So that is what is said here also, that this Om, so much is said about Om. Etad eva aksharam brahma, etad eva aksharam param. So Om is both the sagun as well as nirgun. And those who can understand, meditate and understand this Om, they can attain both the sagun as well as the nirgun. So yo yad ichchasi tasya tata. Further, Yamraj says, he continues with that praise of Om. Etadalambanam shreshtham. Etadalambanam param. Etadalambanam nyatva. Brahmaloke mahiyate. Etadalambanam. Etadalambanam param. So etad alambanam param shreshtham. Shrestham means the best. Alambanam means support. Support for whom? Support for the seeker. Those who are seeking that supreme, those who want to attain that state of enlightenment, Om is a support. There are some who don't require this support also. They are very more advanced seeker. They might not require the support of Om. But others require support. And we have lot of supports, like we in the beginning our action itself becomes support in our sadhana. Karma yoga, we perform action in order to purify our mind. Mind is subtle, actions are gross. So by performing these gross actions with a particular attitude, our mind start becoming more and more pure. So actions and the attitude becomes a support for purifying our mind. Similarly, we do different types of japa, puja, upasana, tirtha yatra, this, that, so many things we do. Those are all supports to purify our mind and help us in our sadhana. But which is the subtlest and the topmost, the Mount Everest of support? That is Om. Om is the subtlest. Subtle doesn't mean that everyone should grab it. Because if it is subtle, then to use it and to take that support also requires proper qualification. But if we have the qualification, then this is the subtlest which will help us to leap into that supreme. So etad alambanam shrestham. It is not a physical object. Like the word, like anything. It is not the written word also. Though we write it in different language, the Om is written differently. Even in so many foreign languages also, it is written in various ways. So, what the way, the written Om is not the, not, we are not talking about that. That is just a way of expressing, writing. Om is sound. It is not something which is written. It is a sound. Sound it is. That sound is represented by some words and all, or some writing, that is a different story. But it is a sound. And sound being the subtlest, see, we have these five elements, and the characteristic of Akash is sound. So Akash is subtlest and the sound is subtlest. So therefore this is a very subtle, what you call, support. It's a mantra. And it is such a small mantra that it conveys the very essence of all the Upanishads and everything. It's the most powerful. So etad alambanam shrestham and etad alambanam param, and it is also this alambanam, this Om, also is Param, that Supreme Brahma, as well as it is that Saguna Brahma. So it indicates both, it is support of both the Supreme as well as the Saguna Brahma. Therefore, etat alambanam nyatva, so one who knows this, that word knowing is used for upasana also. It is not just blindly or not knowing, just chanting or doing, but it is when we know about it and meditate on it, knowing the meaning, meditating on the meaning, then only it becomes effective. Otherwise also, if we chant at Om, regularly practice it and focus our attention on the sound also, that also is very helpful. Even the sound Om, we focus on the beginning of that Om, the middle of the Om, and as it becomes that humming sound, and then silence. Even focusing on that Om is a very good sadhana. But that is only one aspect. Second is to contemplate on the meaning conveyed by that sound. We have to constantly contemplate on that meaning, so that when we utter that Om, we don't have to then think, it should immediately bring to our attention the meaning. We don't have to think. See, there are certain, for example, on the traffic we have that stop sign written, STOP. So in the beginning, in childhood and all, we might have to read every letter separately, STOP, stop. Then slowly we got used to it, we can just look at it and read the word stop. But later on as we grow, we don't even read the word stop. When we look at that word, it conveys the meaning to us. You understand? We don't see STOP, stop. Stop means rukna, chalo ruk jate hai. Aisa nahi. That looking at that, it no longer remains as a word, it becomes a symbol, it becomes it directly gives the message. Similarly, Om in the beginning, you might be thinking, A is this, U is this, Ma is this, silence is this. Then when we further progress on our path, just uttering that Om and all the Ma, as we utter, our mind will focus on the meaning automatically. And by the time we reach that silence, we will reach that state of Samadhi. Ultimately, we have to chant that Om once only. So once we chant, and that we meditate on the whole, that gross physical world, U, the subtle world, Ma, the subtlest world, and then the silence, we get established in the truth. If once it doesn't happen, then we repeat. So etad alambanam sreshtam, etad alambanam param, etad alambanam nyatva, brahma loke mahiyate. And one who knows this means one who gains the full benefit of this sadhana, he attains that brahma lok. Brahma lok, one is sagun brahma, as well as if he meditates on the nirgun, he attains that state of nirgun avastha. That brahma lok indicate both. The sagun upasak attains the sagun brahma avastha, means he attains that state of Hiranyagarbha or that creator, or they attain that state of nirgun nirakar brahma. So brahma loke mahiyate. So in the beginning, Yamrajji indicated this Om and the Omkar Upasana to Nachiket. The subtlest support is given to him. And if we do this sadhana, slowly and steadily our mind will become pure. And so pure that we will not require the support also. Now the next verse, Yamrajji is directly indicating that supreme reality without any support. No Om, no support. Directly he is indicating to the highest seeker, the truth is indicated. If that is not comprehended directly, then we take the support of Om. If Om is also not helping us, then we go to some other grosser sadhana. So let us see how the truth is indicated. Na jayate mriyate va vipaschita. Nayam kutaschinna babhuva kaschita. Ajo nitya shashvato yam puranaha. Na hanyate hanyamane sharire. Na jayate mriyate va vipaschita. Nayam kutaschinna babhuva kaschita. So this shloka, this mantra reminds us of the shloka in Bhagavad Gita also. Bhagavad Gita came later on. This Upanishad was even before Bhagavad Gita. So even Bhagavad Gita got some inspiration from this Upanishad. Slight difference is there in Bhagavad Gita Shloka, but it's more or less similar. Na jayate mriyate va kadachida nayam bhutva bhavita va na bhuyah ajo nityas shashvato yam puranah na hanyate hanyamane sharire. Like that it is in Bhagavad Gita, second chapter. Here it's slight difference. So this is an indicator of that supreme Atma. Atma is indicated. Atma cannot be defined. That supreme reality cannot be defined. To define something, we require some qualities. Then we can define. Because anything we define with qualities only. Let us say if you want to talk about a flower, rose, you can talk about its color, you can talk about its softness, you can talk about its fragrance. So many things we can talk about it. One can go on and on. But if it doesn't have any color, suppose there is a rose which has no color, it has no form, it has no fragrance, it has no weight, it has nothing, it cannot be seen, it cannot be touched, it cannot be smelt, it cannot be thought of, then very difficult to talk about it. And that is what Atma is. Because all that we can talk about is this Prakriti only, Sattvic, Rajasic, Tamasic, and whatever is made up of it. So if a thing doesn't have any qualities, it is existing, it is, but it doesn't have any qualities to define it, it becomes very difficult. So it can be only indicated with the help of few markers. So these are the markers or pointers indicating that supreme reality. So the first thing which Bhagavan says, Yamaraj says, is na jayate. This self is something which is not born. It doesn't take birth. It is not something which is born. Atma is not born. Because it is always there. Its very nature is pure existence. It is not born. Something which is not there can take birth. And that which takes birth undergoes modification. And then finally dies also. So asti, jayate, vartate, viparinamate, and all various changes happen in that which is born. So Atma is that which is not born, na jayate. Hence, na mriyate, it doesn't die. Also there are no intermediate changes in that Atma. It doesn't grow, it doesn't decay, it doesn't modify. So there is no change happening in that Atma Tattva. See, in science, there is something called dark energy. Also, there is something called dark matter, but that matter we'll keep it aside. Dark energy or dark matter also, if you take, they don't know what it is. They know it is there, but they don't know what it is. What is its nature? See, about 75% of the matter is dark matter. What we experience is hardly some 4-5%. That's what they say. So, that dark matter, why can't you tell anything about it? Because it doesn't react with anything. You cannot stop it, you cannot push it, you cannot strangle it. It doesn't get mixed with anything. It remains aloof. You cannot talk about anything about it because it doesn't react with other matter. So they don't know what it is. It's not antimatter, it's dark matter. It So they cannot tell about it, what it is. Similarly, this Atma Tattva is something which does not react with anything. It doesn't react with Prakriti. Sattva Gun doesn't have any effect on it. Rajo Gun doesn't have any effect on it. Tamo Gun doesn't have any effect on this Atma. Thoughts do not touch it. Senses cannot see it. Mind cannot think about it. But it is there. Very strange. One knows that it is there, but one cannot define it. It's like eyes. I can see everything in this world. I cannot see the eyes themselves. You cannot see your eyes. You can see reflection of your eyes maybe, but you can't see your eyes. So how do you know you have eyes? The very fact I can see, that means I have eyes. But seeing is believing. You have to see your eyes. I can't see. With my eyes, however much I try, I can't see. Similarly, because of the presence of that self, everything functions. Everything has got existence. Everything seems to be existing, though it is not real, but seems to be existing because of the presence of self. Like this watch, it's not real, but it seems to be existing. It is jada, inert, but there is knowledge of it, so that one is conscious of it. So one can infer, the inference of the nature of Atma is that it is Sat Chit Ananda. You cannot even say it is Sat Chit Ananda, but the nearest we can say about it is Sat Chit Ananda. It's like sugar. What is the nature of sugar? Sweet, we say. Sweet, why we say? Because when we touch it to our tongue, we experience sweetness. You put it in your eyes, very sweet, huh? It will start burning, eyes will start burning. Put it in your nose. I mean, don't do it, but I'm just saying. Otherwise, you say, Swami ji ne kaha, main pura dal diya aur raat mein chitiyan ne kha liya mere naak ko. We say sugar is sweet, not because sugar is sweet, but when that sugar, that particle comes in contact with our tongue, we experience sweetness. That doesn't make sugar sweet. Our experience of sugar through tongue is sweet. Our experience of sugar through eyes is different. But what exactly is sugar? What is its nature? Nobody can tell. We just tell the reaction of sugar to our tongue, not the actual sugar. Actual sugar, if you want to know, you have to become sugar. Even if you become sugar, you will not know what I am. Similarly, the presence of self makes everything appear to be existing. It is not existing, but everything appears to be existing. Everything, we are aware of everything. So there is awareness, there is existence, and there is peace and bliss. So we can just infer that Atma is Sat Chit Ananda Swarup. But when we get established in it, when we transcend this Prakriti, when we transcend this mind, what we experience we cannot express. It cannot be said. So the realized master who have experienced that self, the nearest they can say is that it is Sat Chit Ananda. Or they use contradictory statements, in the sense it is neither large nor small, like that. We will see further. So, the self is indicated here as na jayate, na mriyate va vipaschit. It is indicated as vipaschit. It is chit, means pure consciousness, intelligence. It is that because of which there is an experience of awareness. All of us, we are aware of this world. We are aware of our waking, dream, deep sleep state. That because of which we are aware is called that Atma. because of that Atma only, there is that experience of awareness. There is experience of consciousness. I am conscious of, we say. So that because of which we have the experience of being conscious, being aware, is called that Atma. By itself we cannot call it consciousness also. You understand? But because of which we have the experience of being conscious. So it is called vipaschit. It's so subtle. See, here now he is pointing out without any support. No om. Directly it is being pointed out. So vipaschit means in consciousness or pure that intelligence. That intelligent Atma is neither born nor does it die. It is always present. Then further, na ayam kutaschit. It is not an effect. It is not come from somewhere. Na ayam kutaschit means it is not born from something. It is not born from something. So it is not an effect. Some many times little children and all ask that if God created everything, who created God? Atma is always, it's of the nature of existence itself. Means it is not something which is born or something is born from it. It is not born from something. So na ayam kutaschit. This is the statement of fact which is indicated here. There is no, it's a factual thing. It's like suppose somebody is given some dish to taste, let us say something, item you make at home after reading in the recipe book. Then you give it to someone to taste and look at his face and look at his blood pressure and all. Whether he's still surviving. So, that person tastes it and he says that it is salty or it is pungent. Suppose we ask why? Why it is salty? Why? No, he's just giving the statement of fact. Similarly, the Rishi Munis are giving the statement of fact. There is no why, how, they are just telling that Atma is like this. It is neither born, nor does it die. And from it nothing has come. So this world has not come from Atma. It is appearing on the self. It is not created by the self. Ishvara did not create the world. Ishvara and everything is appearing. The world is appearing. It has not been created, that somebody sat there and created the world, nothing like that. The term creation itself is not accepted. So there is no creation in that sense. It is experience, the world is experience at present. And when we go into the state of samadhi, it is not experience. So it is just experience at one particular level of our consciousness. So na ayam kutaschit, so nothing, it is not born from something, and na babhuva kaschit, nor something is born from it. So it is not a cause which has created something, nor is it an effect which has been created by something else. So na babhuva kaschit and na ayam kutaschit. Therefore, this Atma is ajaha, unborn, no birth, unborn, untouched by time, unborn, nityaha, eternal. It is always there. It's always there. It is eternal. Shashvataha, it is changeless. Everlasting, changeless. Puranaha. Purana means very ancient, but at the same time new, fresh, new. Pura api navam. means it is untouched by time. It is not touched by time. It is always fresh and new. So pura api navam. And na hanyate hanyamane sharire. It doesn't get destroyed even when the body is destroyed. Even if our gross, if this gross physical body or mind or even the subtler body gets destroyed or killed or slain, the Atma is not slain. Atma is not slain. This is most fascinating. Our own country has given to us these great scriptures. Great Rishi Munis were born in this land of ours. And these great Upanishads are here in our country. But in the same country, we have a lot of misunderstanding of Atma. Everyone talks about Atma as though some object which is residing in the body. When a person dies, Atma chali gayi uski. Pata nahi kahan bhatak rahi hai. Uski Atma. We use the word Atma for everything then. Right from ghost to everything. Ghost is not Atma. Jiva is not Atma. Mind is not Atma. Buddhi is not Atma. Any object of this world is not Atma. Atma is not energy. Some people like to use the word energy like anything. They feel little below their dignity to use the word God or anything technical word from our scriptures. They like to use scientific word. God is some type of energy. And the more they shake their hands, they feel it is more esoteric it is. I believe God to be some energy. Yeah, very good. So, Atma is not any energy. Atma is not matter. E is equal to mc square doesn't touch Atma. It is about the world. World is made up of energy and matter. Prakriti is made up of energy and matter. Energy is nothing but the rajogun. Matter is tamogun. Intelligence is sattvagun, which makes the energy and matter function.